तव कथामृतं तप्त जीवनं कविभिरीडितं कल्मषापहं श्रवणमंगलं श्रीमदाततं भुवि गृणन्ति ते भूरिदा जनाः. टुडे इज़ दि होली डे ऑफ दि बर्थडे ऑफ Swami Akhandananda-ji. Swami Akhandananda-ji was one of the 16 monastic disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. And he was one of the most adventurous Swamis, next only to Swami Vivekananda. That is why Swami Vivekananda used to have a special love for Swami Akhandananda, who was called Gangadhar in his previous life, in his pre-monastic life. Gangadhar. So, Gangadhar, he make into Ganga into Ganges. Swami Vivekananda used to call him Ganges. I love you more than others, he used to say. So, this Swami, Swami Gangadhar, Gangadhar Bandopadhyay, Gangadhar Banerjee, he was born to Vama Sundari, the mother, and father was Srimanta Bandopadhyay. He was born on a Friday and a Mahalaya. Today also is Friday and Mahalaya. But it was 1864, September 30. Today is October 4. He had three sisters, elder to him, and he was the fourth. Naturally, the parents had prayed for a son and he was born, fulfilling their expectation. And it is said that his mother had no labor pain at all when he was born. She was just resting on a mat and he was born without any labor pain. So from the very young age, he was a very different type of boy. Like a yogi, not interested in anything in the outside world. It is said that as a boy, small boy, somebody presented, some relative of him, presented him with a gold chain, thin chain. After all, a child has to wear that. So a thin gold chain was presented to him. So his mother put it around his neck. This boy would not allow it to be on his neck. He pulled at it in such a way, tore it and threw it away. Then only he could find peace. And as he grew up, just as a small boy, he had a tremendous power of concentration, which is very rare. Children are very little concentrated. Their mind is pure. They can have a lot of concentration, but they are restless. So they concentrate for a short while, but that concentration goes away. So on different objects they will concentrate. They cannot concentrate on one single thing. But this boy had a tremendous power of concentration. On a single object he could go on concentrating. For example, he would tell his friends when they would go near a mango tree or some fruit tree, I will make that mango on the third branch fall down. So he will only hit at the third one. He will not hit any other mango. He will hit that mango alone, must fall down. So that was his way of training his mind. He had a tremendous power of concentration from the young age. And he had a tremendous power of forbearance also. Forbearance in Vedantic language, the spiritual language, is called titiksha. Titiksha means to bear and forbear. Whatever happens to you, you never complain. You just swallow the whole lot. How you swallow it is a different thing. So, it's called titiksha, a great spiritual quality. It was natural to him. Even as a young boy, it is said, he was 8 years of age, when there was a wound between his eyebrows. So, they had to lance it. They had to give him some local anesthesia. He said, no, I don't require an anesthesia. You lance it straight away. Then they simply applied the knife without any chloroform or without any anesthesia. He stood. He did not even shake a little. And the operation was successful. So he had a tremendous power of forbearance from the very beginning, even from his 8th year. He first met Sri Ramakrishna when he was hardly 12 years old. He was born in 1864. In 1876, or 12 years old, Sri Ramakrishna had come to a devotee's house who was a police officer called Kabinath Basu. So the Kabinath Basu, in the Kalinath Basu, he was in Calcutta, Sri Ramakrishna had come to his house. So this boy and his other colleagues, they heard that Sri Ramakrishna has come. He is a great saint. He has come from Dakshineshwar. So they all went with great eagerness to see this great man from Dakshineshwar. They actually saw him. Sri Ramakrishna was in spiritual ecstasy. He was singing and getting into a spiritual mood, high spiritual mood. He was singing, Ashi Toje Bunshiloye Akbar Nacho Go Shyama. That is a Bengali song. He is praying to Mother Kali, O Mother, give up your sword and take instead the flute of Krishna and you be like Krishna. In Bengal there is a belief that Krishna and Kali are the same. Sometimes Kali becomes Krishna and Krishna also can become Kali. So he was singing a song, you please, O Mother, give up your sword and then take the flute and then like Krishna you dance. So this boy who heard the song was very much impressed, and Sri Ramakrishna was in ecstasy. When he was used to be in ecstasy, a divine light would emanate from his body. So naturally this 12-year-old boy was very much charmed by that scene, and that impression was very deep on his mind. In the meanwhile, he was very much attached to the different sannyasins and other monastic people who used to come near his house. So one Swami belonging to the Udasi Sampradaya. So this Udasi Sadhu, he came, and then this small boy, 13 or 14 year old boy, he was very much impressed by him and his stories of going to different pilgrimages. So he volunteered, I will also come with you, take me. In those times, you know, the sadhus were also very simple and the householders also were very simple. He said, all right, it's a good thing after all to go to different pilgrimages, especially with a sadhu. It will do good to you, come. So he took that boy away. So they walked off. Perhaps his mother was not there at home. When the mother returned, she found the son has disappeared from home. Then she inquired here and there. Then somebody said that he has walked away with a Udasi monk. So then the mother started searching out for her son. She went to pilgrimage after pilgrimage. Wherever she goes, she doesn't get any information. So she went to different holy places like Varanasi, like Allahabad, Vrindavan, Haridwar. So all those places she visited, wherever Swamis are there, she could not find her son. Then, exasperated, she returned on her way. She met Trailanga Swami, the great Paramahamsa, who had met Sri Ramakrishna also, Holy Mother also. And this mother, she met Trailanga Swami and told him, my son has gone away from home. I am in search of him. I am very much distressed. So that Paramahamsa took pity on her and blessed her. No, don't worry, your son will return. And she was very much assured When she came back to Calcutta, her son was back at home. Then he told, I have only gone with the sadhu. I went to different pilgrimages and came back. But mother was very cross with him. She just took him to town. Why did you take birth in me here? You are born in this house only to give me trouble like this. Then he says, why? I have made you to go to all the pilgrimages. Because I went away like that only, you could visit all the pilgrimages. Otherwise, would you have given up your household duties and gone all the way to the pilgrimages? So mother was silent. What could she say about this sort of a fantastic reply which she never expected from her son? So that was his young age sports. Then he met Sri Ramakrishna for the second time when he was about 19 years in 1883 at Dakshineshwar. So when he came to Sri Ramakrishna, Sri Ramakrishna asked him, what do you do at your home? He said, I take bath 3 times in Ganga and I just chew the Haritaki. Haritaki is a sort of a myrobalam, they say. Kajika and Solomon, the Kajika. So the vayala potunda, that will keep the throat very clear. So Haritaki, Harra, they say in Hindi. He used to chew that one. And he would do pranayama. He would never chew any pan. Pan chewing is very common in the north. Everybody goes on chewing pan. And he would never chew pan. That was his austerity. And he would practice pranayama, especially kumbhak pranayama. And then he would take only boiled rice with a little salt and ghee. That's called havishyanna, simplest food. So he would take several days. All this sort of austerity when he was 19 years old and he's a college boy. Sri Ramakrishna made him sit near him. And then he asked him the question, have you seen me earlier at any time? He had seen him when he was 12 years old. So he told, yes sir, when I was a small boy. Now itself you are a small boy, 19 years old. So there is another small boyhood for you or what? So Sri Ramakrishna was surprised by his answer. Then asked him to come again on a Saturday. A Saturday is a very, very good day, Madhuvar. It is a sweet day, Sri Ramakrishna remarked. So, and afterwards he started meeting him on Saturdays also. So, the next meeting, Sri Ramakrishna made him sit on a mat and Sri Ramakrishna wrote something on his tongue and then made him sit and advised him how to sit. You should not sit bent. And neither stiff straight, normal way of sitting straight. So you should sit with the chest and neck and face in one line, slightly bent forward. So this is the normal pose. So Sri Ramakrishna taught him. Then asked him to massage his feet. That was the way Sri Ramakrishna used to give opportunity for his disciples to serve him. So Gangadhar used to practice physical exercises and attend gymnasium. He used to practice wrestling also. His hands were very hard. So he pressed Sri Ramakrishna's legs so hard, Sri Ramakrishna was simply shouted with pain. No, no, mildly, mildly, you massage very mildly. Then Gangadhar felt his feet very, very soft. He said, even his bones were like made of butter. So soft was the body of Sri Ramakrishna. Then another day, Sri Ramakrishna remarked, you are so young. Why do you practice all sorts of these oldish regulations of food, eating havishyanna and not chewing pan and all that? See, Narendra, he eats everything. But and he takes any number of paan. He chooses any number of paan. But he sees only God everywhere when he walks on the streets of Calcutta. Go and meet him. So that is what the Sri Ramakrishna's way of austerity. Austerity should be to turn your mind to God. The mind must be full of spiritual thoughts. That is the real austerity. Not what we eat or drink outside. So he gave the example of Narendra. He takes paan and he eats whatever comes his way. But she is only Narayana, God everywhere, in everyone, when he walks on the streets of Calcutta. So, divine eyes. That can happen only when you see God is within yourselves. You can see God outside. What we are inside, we see outside. So, Narendra was spiritual, highly spiritual. So, he didn't observe all these useless customs of not chewing a paan and feeling proud about it. You may not chew paan, but why should you feel proud about it? There is nothing to be felt proud about it. So he advised him like that. Another day, when Gangadhar came to Sri Ramakrishna, after meditation, Sri Ramakrishna asked him, how did you meditate today? Did you shed tears for mother? Then he did not reply anything. Then Sri Ramakrishna showed him how to shed tears for mother and call on her. Sri Ramakrishna threw both his hands like that, both his legs like that, like a small child. Oh mother, oh mother, oh mother, he started shouting, shedding profuse tears. And Gangadhar himself was moved. What is this? Just like a child. He's shouting at mother as if he had lost his mother just now. And for a long time, Sri Ramakrishna was weeping. So that was the instruction he was giving to Gangadhar, how to cry for mother, just like a small child which has lost its mother. So just shouts, throwing all his limbs like that, and tears, with tears in his eyes, he shouts for the mother. Sri Ramakrishna said, tears of joy should fall like that. Then only mother will reveal herself. Then another day, he gave a few coins in the hand of Gadadhar to be given to a beggar. So he gave the few paisas to the beggar and came back. Sri Ramakrishna asked him, wash your hands with Ganga Jal, with water of Ganga. You have touched the money, then you have polluted your hand. Wash your hand with Ganga water. That is how he taught that you are going to be a great Swami, great sannyasin. The sannyasin must have absolutely no attachment to money. So, never touch even the money. So, from that age itself, he taught him, never covet money. So, he made him wash his hands because he had touched the few coins. So, similarly, see, taught him swadharma nishta. He said each should hold on to one's own religion. Sri Ramakrishna never believed in changing religions or conversion, as we say today. He never encouraged any type of conversion. Not only the conversion of Hindus into other religion. If any other religion person got converted into Hinduism also, he would object. The case in point was, there was the Theosophical Society in India. It started way back, quite old, in 1880s. The Theosophical Society was there. You will read in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. People talk about Theosophical Society and ask Sri Ramakrishna about questions about theosophy and all that. So in Theosophical Society there was a big leader, Colonel Wolcott. He was one of the presidents of the Theosophical Society of Adyar. This Adyar Theosophical Society is one of the oldest in the world. It was the world's headquarters here. Though it originated in USA, its headquarters was in Adyar only. So Colonel Wolcott was there. Swami Vivekananda met him. This Colonel Wolcott, he was attracted to Buddhism of Sri Lanka. He became a Buddhist. Giving up his Christianity, he became a Buddhist. In theosophy, you can be a Buddhist, you can be Hindu, all the religions can be there. You can be a theosophist, at the same time you can be a Buddhist. So he changed his religion from Christianity to Buddhism. This news spread like wildfire all over our country because a white man had changed. So they interpreted that Buddhism was Hinduism. Oh, Colonel Wolcott has become a Hindu. So it spread like a wildfire. Then Gangadhar once reported, this one, you see that Colonel Wolcott has become a Hindu, to Sri Ramakrishna. Immediately Sri Ramakrishna said, why? Why did he change his religion? He should not have changed. He has been born as a Christian. He should have followed his Christianity. He could have reached God by that way itself. Why did he change? This is the Catholicity of Sri Ramakrishna, which Swami Akhandananda noticed. And then, so one day, while serving Sri Ramakrishna, Gangadhar touched Sri Ramakrishna's feet and took the dust of his feet and touched his forehead, because Sri Ramakrishna used to say that the sattvic devotees, they don't make any marks outside. They don't wear either the vibhuti or the tirunamam. So they just touch their forehead with Ganga water or Kaveri water. Nobody will see. So that is how the sattvic devotees go unnoticed. So just to follow his advice, he took the dust of Sri Ramakrishna's feet and touched his forehead. Sri Ramakrishna was amused at the way of practicing his teaching. One day, Gangadhar was standing in the temple of Kali. Sri Ramakrishna was also very nearby. Suddenly Sri Ramakrishna remarked, look, Sri Ram, Shiva is breathing, Shiva is living, look at Shiva. And those of you have seen the Dakshineshwar Kali temple, Shiva is lying like that and Kali is standing with one leg on his chest, one on his legs. So she is standing like that. And that Shiva is just looking above at the eyes of Kali. Since Sri Ramakrishna remarked, see at Shiva, he is living, he is seeing. Then Gangadhar looks, really Shiva was living. His eyes are moving, his lips are moving, and he is looking at Kali, and he is in an ecstatic mood. So clearly he saw, and Shiva was breathing also. Suddenly, a living vision of Shiva was given to him by Sri Ramakrishna. Like this, several experiences he had with his guru. In 1886, August 16th, as you all know, Sri Ramakrishna attained Mahasamadhi. At that time, Gangadhar was only a brahmachari. So, he did not take sannyas. We all know that within 1 year, all the other disciples, except Swami Vijnanandaji and Gangadhar, they all took sannyas before 1887. But this Gangadhar, after Sri Ramakrishna passed away, he developed so much of renunciating spirit. He gave up everything, took his father's blessings and went away to Himalayas for big Tirthyatra. And we see, roaming about in Himalayas for 4 years, he did not come down at all. And how would he go? He would walk without any slippers. So all the 4 years on the ice and on the rocks and on all the thorn affected roads, he would walk only with bare foot. 4 years he has travelled all over Himalaya. So before he started his pilgrimages in the Himalayas, you always start with the entrance at Rishikesh. Rishikesh is the gateway for all the Himalayan Tirthas. He went to Rishikesh. There was one big Swami. He was called Mayaram Avadhut. Very great saint. He had gone several times through all the pilgrimages in the Himalayas. He was old, so he was in his ashram. So he was delivering some lecture. So this young Swami entered his lecture. And then he went and asked, "Sir, which is the road to Kedarnath?" From Kedarnath, he wants to start his journey. He asked, "Sir, which is the road to Kedarnath?" Then naturally, Mayaram has gone several times. He said, "That is the road." He showed him the route. And that was the right royal road. It is a hill road going upwards towards the Himalayas. Then Gangadhar looked at the door. He remarked, "That is only an ordinary road. I thought the road to Kedarnath will be from jumping from one hill to the another. I thought that should be the way." So I had he was ready to do that. Mayaram was taken aback by the determination of this young Swami. He said, "What determination he has, knowing that he has to jump from one peak to the other. He has come ready to take the journey." So he said, "This is the power of his guru. If the guru is strong, the disciple becomes strong like that. Guru meharban, to chela pahalwan," he said. If the guru is gracious, then the chela, the disciple, becomes very strong. So that is how he was got the encomium and praise of one of the great avadhuts, Mayaram avadhut. Then he started his journey to several pilgrimages, Kedarnath, Badrinath, and other. So many tirthas are there. And he met a trader's party that was going into Tibet. Tibet was a place which was not allowed for outsiders to enter. It was a place of secret. So first of all, Tibetans themselves did not want other people to come. And the Indian government also did not want any of the Indians to go there. They did not allow. But then he joined the traders' party. He was very eager to see Tibet. So he left on the road and he started walking along with them. So they reached almost Tibet, the central part of a place where a big Buddhist monastery was there. So just a parting of way. The traders had to go on another way. They just told him, "So your monastery is very near, you can go this way." They showed a route and then they went away. But by the time they went away and he was ready to go, it became very dark. In the Himalayas, those that have lived, you know, suddenly it becomes dark. So it hardly takes 10 minutes. You are thinking there is enough of light. In 10 minutes the whole thing will become dark. So it became so dark. He did not know how which road to go. So without knowing any road, how will he go? All full of ice all over. On the ice he lay himself down, went to sleep. Most dangerous thing. If you sleep on ice, your nerves will all get frigid. And then you will never get up, finished. You will pass away. So you will pass away very peacefully, but you will never come back finished. So he was sleeping on this ice whole night. So in the morning, some monks from the monastery of Kuling, that place was called Kuling, though some of the monks came and saw somebody lying down on the ice. They thought he is dead. So when they found him, alive yet, not completely conscious, but alive, they immediately took him and just gave him some first aid and he came back to life. They all shouted, "Gelam, Gelam." Gelam in Tibetan means he is a very, very self-controlled sannyasi. He is a very chaste and celibate sannyasi. That is why he could survive sleeping on the ice for the whole night. So then he started living among the Buddhist monks for quite some time. And then afterwards, there was a lot of experience. He later on used to recount. We have got the memories of Swami Akhandananda about his life with the lamas. Lamas could be very, very strict and punish their subjects. So he wanted to help some poor people. that lamas did not want. So this fellow wants, if he goes against us, we will cut off his both the cheeks. So because he will speak to all the people, encouraging them to do this, do that. So if he cuts off the cheeks, you cannot speak at all. All the air will go here this way and that way. So they were ready to punish him like that. All the memories of Akhandananda we get. Then after living for some time, then from there he walks off. Then starts moving about in the other difficult places in Himalayas. To one place, he was there, so it was evening. So he was trying to cross that jungle and go to the village on the other side. So he entered the jungle. So it was already dark, twilight. When he entered the jungle, it becomes completely dark. So when the darkness came, then he is smelling fresh blood all around. Fresh bones are there. That means the wild animals have brought some animals and they have eaten that one and throw the fresh blood and fresh bones. He is getting the smell of all that. But he also felt that somebody was guiding him on the right path, even in the darkness, and he safely came and reached the next village. He used to say, Sri Ramakrishna himself saved me on that night. Another night, he was in a jungle. So he found, what is the good of traveling in the jungle now? Let me sit in a place and meditate. He started meditating. As soon as he started meditation, Sri Ramakrishna appeared in his divine vision. And then, this time, and Sri Ramakrishna started talking to him, singing songs, putting his hand on his shoulders. Both of them started dancing. So dancing, Sri Ramakrishna was telling him, you see, this whole of Himalaya and its greenery, it is like Shiva and Shakti. Whole Himalaya and the greenery is there. With both of them are Shiva and Shakti. They are playing. It is full of joy. And they also went on dancing all round, all through the night, singing about Mother Shama. Bajbe go Maheshir buke. So, O Mother, dance on the chest of Shiva. So, like that, singing. Ramakrishna was singing and both of them were dancing. So it was almost morning, suddenly Sri Ramakrishna disappeared. Then only Akhandananda could think that it was only vision. He was thinking that Sri Ramakrishna was physically with him. They were in an ecstatic world. When you are in the dream, you never know that you are in a dream. Only when you wake up, you think it is a dream. Similarly, in a divine vision, you are transported into a different state of consciousness. There, everything is a different thing. The divine world, divine Sri Ramakrishna, and we are also divine there. So that is how we spent the whole night. And then, next day morning when he saw, he was no more there. He came to know it was a long vision, whole night, vision of Sri Ramakrishna. And then, the night passed, it was dawn, and the vision vanished. Then he returned from the pilgrimages. After almost 4 years, when he was coming down, maybe somewhere in Rishikesh or Uttarkashi, somewhere, he found Swami Shivanandaji. Shivanandaji just saw him. He could not recognize him at all. Because of this staying for 4 years in that cold, without proper food and proper raiment, proper clothing, he had become completely black. So this Gangadhar was a fair-looking person, fair-complexioned person. It became completely black. First of all, he could not be recognized at all. Then Gangadhar himself started shouting, Dada, Dada, Tarakda, Tarakda. Then, you know, Shivananji came to know that this is Gangadhar. So that was after 44 years, he comes back to Varanagar Mutt, where other sannyasis were all there. Then Swami Vivekananda was also there. And then they started living there. At that time he took sannyas. Others had already taken sannyas. He took sannyas and his name became Akhandananda. So from Gangadhar, he became Akhandananda. Sri Ram, Swamiji used to be very much enamored of this adventurous Swami. At that time, perhaps very, very few people, even adventurous people, had entered Tibet. This young Swami has entered Tibet and brought so much of news about Tibet and experiences. So Swamiji always used to make him, praise him in many ways. He used to call him Barfani Baba, the saint or the monk from the Iceland, Barfani Baba. So he also called him Ganges, because Gangadhar, he used to call him Ganges. So he used to mock at him also by singing a song. There was a famous song. Seema ke beech mein aseem deshaka kon athiti ayare. So there is a famous song at that time. So some saint is singing, into this world of limited things, how does the infinite God come? So that was a famous song. So imitating that one, see, Swamiji used to make a song singing about Tarwal ke naak wala sadhu kahan se aaya hai. He used to sing. So lot of fun used to be there in the Varaha Vedan Mutt. Then the pilgrimage of Swamiji started. So Swamiji wanted to go away and all alone. And Akhandananda would say, no, I will follow you. Wherever you go, I will find you out. Then Swamiji said, Swamiji went away. Then Swamiji went away. After some time, Akhandananda started trying to find out where Swamiji has gone. So Swamiji wanted to see Swamiji. And he, wherever he comes, they say he has left that place some 3 days back or 4 days back. So where he has gone, they don't know. So he goes to the next place. By that time he has gone, Swamiji has left to some other place. So he goes to Baroda, he goes to Ahmedabad, he goes to Junagadh, he goes to Porbandar, then Dwarka, Bhuj, then Kach Mandavi. Kach Mandavi, Ashapuri, Narayan Sarovar. All these places, especially that Kach Mandavi, Narayan Sarovar area, was full of dacoits. Those dacoits would murder anybody if they got 1 rupee on that person. For 1 rupee, they will take him and then they will kill him. Not for anything else, but you know, he will go and report to the police. So they will be in trouble. Therefore, why leave him up? Simply kill him. Take 1 rupee and kill him. Such a dangerous place it was. So he has gone through that place in search of Swamiji. Up to Narayan Sarovar he went. In Narayan Sarovar, just 3-4 days back, he had left to some other place. Then, you know, he traces his way back. Then he was afraid that suppose on my way to see Swamiji, this dacoit catch hold of me. Suddenly I got a few rupees with me. So they take the rupee and kill me. What would happen? Then all my efforts will go in vain. So he asked the people, you see, I am going this way. Suppose the dacoits catch me. What should I say to escape from them? Please, you can take away whatever with me, but don't kill me. Suppose, what do you say in this dacoit's language? They taught him. So he learned 2 sentences. What are those 2 sentences? Medegano, medegano. Muke mario mu. 2 sentences. Medegano, medegano. Take away, whatever I have. Like everything. Muje, muke mario mu. Don't kill me. So he committed this to memory. Actually the robbers came. The dacoits came. Caught hold of him. Tied him up. Tried to tie him up. He said, don't try. I'm not going to run away. I'm not a coward. So you don't tie. Whatever you want, you take away. Medegano, medegano, he told. Take away, take away. Muke mario mu. Don't kill me. So they did not kill him. So he escaped from there. And after traveling another 75 miles, so he came to a place called Ashapuri. There he found Swami Vivekananda. And his first meeting was so much thrilled. He described that first meeting as I saw Swamiji sitting amidst so many learned people, talking to them in a room. I never saw Swamiji at all. There was only a big light and ideas were coming one after another. I was made to realize that Swamiji was not a man, he was an idea. And the whole room was filled with the light of his ideas. All people were thrilled with his ideas. They were spellbound. So at that time I saw Swamiji shining as a brilliant idea. Swamiji was not a person, but he was an idea itself. Then Swamiji did not like Gangadhar to take such risks to following him. Then he begged him, because he had asked him not to follow, but he would not leave him. Then he begged him, please leave me, I have got some experiences that I can do it, I can get those experiences only as a lonely traveler, not in the company of others. So please allow me to go alone. Then he said, all right, I will allow you. Afterwards he did not follow him. Then Swamiji went away. Then Akhandananda Swami took another way. So he meets so many great sadhus. One sadhu he met was Jandubhat Vittalji. What now we find so many Ayurvedic medicines, Jandu medicine. His Jandubhat Vittalji himself was a great Vaidyaraj. He was called the king of doctors. This Vaidyaraj Jandubhat Vittalji was a highly spiritual man. He would bring the patients to his own house, serious patients, whom even the householders would not keep with their house. He would bring such patients into his own house. He would wash them, clean them, give them all food, required food, and treat them with medicine until he was cured. So many cases he had cured. And if people asked, why do you do like that? You are a big doctor and you could allow this one to be done by others. Then it seems he used to say, no, I always pray to God, please show me that path by which I can enter into everybody's misery and take a share of their misery upon myself and make them happy. So that is a great shloka. Konunasyat upayo atra yenaham sarvadehinam antapravishya satatam bhaveyam dukkha bhara bhak. May be the sharer of the misery of others by entering into their heart and taking away their misery upon me. This was a great shloka from the Bhagavata, where one king, Rantideva, he prays like that to God. Let us enter into the other's heart to share their miseries and reduce their misery. So such great people, he met several of them, and when he repeated all this to Swamiji, Swamiji was simply, he himself was moved to tears after hearing all these experiences. Then he returned to Alam Bazar Mutt in 1897. In that time, Swami Vivekananda has returned. As soon as he has returned, there was a plague in Calcutta. There was a plague relief going on. Then afterwards, one day, Swami Akhandananda thought, let me go to the nearby place, to Calcutta, the Murshidabad. Murshidabad is very near Plassey. The town Plassey is the first town in which the British entered with their army into Bengal. In south, of course, they had entered Madras. They had built this Fort St. George. In Bengal, when they entered, the first place they entered with 100 soldiers. There were about 1 crore of other people. But they could have made chutney of those 100 soldiers if they want. But people were so imbecile, they did not do anything. With 100 soldiers, they entered Plassey. And afterward, they spread and made the whole country slaves to them. So Akhandananda Swami wanted to go and see that place. Let me go and see that Plassey. After seeing Plassey, he was returning to Baranagar or to Alam Bazar Mutt. On the way, there was a place called small village, Bhapta. There, there was a small temple. It was night, so he slept there for the night. Next day morning, he wanted to come away. So when he was about to get up in the morning, he was pressed down by some force. So he wanted to get up again. Again he was pressed down. Somebody was placing his hands on his shoulder and make him sit down again. Three times it happened. Then he heard a sort of a divine voice saying, where will you go? You have a lot to do here. Then he thought, this is the divine will. Later on he found that whole year was full of famine. People were dying of famine, starvation. So he said, I must do something for them. So he first went to several places and got some food by begging and went to other people who were starving. He served them with that one. Then some other mutt invited him for a big food, nimantran. So he went for a sort of a feast. So all the thing they gave, he did not eat. He took more than half of that with him and went and fed the hungry people. Like that, he started the relief work in Mohula. That was the place, the present, what we call a Sargachi. So that place, he started this relief work. When he started relief work, our mutt came to know, Belur mutt, what is this? You yourself are a beggar. How are you going to help these thousands of people who are starving? Come away, you are a monk. Then Akhandananda wrote, what? To run away from people suffering? I was not born for that. I will not run away leaving people in suffering like a coward. I will face death if necessary, but I will meet this challenge. So he did it in such a brave way. He went into the mosques when they were on Friday. Namaz used to be there. He would go to the mosques and ask these Muslims, you see, people are dying, please give something so that we can save their life. Muslims used to contribute. He went to the collector, so, and then you please give something from the government, collected some money for the government. Like that, he saved thousands, hundreds of people from starvation and death. So, and then some orphans were there. So he took the orphans under his care. Later on, he started an orphanage there at that place called Mahula, which is now called the present Sargachi, where we have got a very big ashram. So there we have got the same, that same orphanage continues along with the school, technical education. So many other things are, and it is one of the very big centers in Calcutta, around Calcutta. And he used to bathe these orphan children as if they are Narayanas themselves. He would pour water on their head for bathing them, telling, Sahasra Shirsha Purusha, Sahasraksha Sahasrapat, the Vedic mantra. Because Swamiji has said, man is none but living Narayana. He showed to the world that it is true. And his children used to be so much attached to him. And he would teach them not only how to live and stand on their own feet by learning some vocation, he would teach them the prayers of Sri Ramakrishna morning and evening. Swami Brahmananji went once to his ashram and saw all the work he was doing. He was very much impressed. In the evening, Brahmananji remarked, he told Gangadhar, you are teaching them so many vocations and you are teaching them games, etc., to make their body strong. You are feeding them well. That is all right. But I don't know how much of good will do to them these things. But you are teaching them to pray to Sri Ramakrishna morning and evening. I am sure this will make them cross this ocean of life. This will make them cross this ocean of life. Three times Brahmananji said, this praying to Sri Ramakrishna once in the morning, once in the evening, your orphan children will cross this ocean of life. So Brahmananji went away. After some time, one of the boys One Muslim boy was there. He had given shelter to every type of orphan, irrespective of religion. This Muslim boy, he was just sitting before the temple in the evening. It was the prayer was about to start. This boy used to daily sit inside the prayer. On that day he was sitting outside the temple and the prayer was going on. Swami Akhandananda was going perhaps for his recess. So when he was going for toilet, he found this boy sitting and looking at Sri Ramakrishna from a distance, sitting outside. Then he, all right, let me enquire while coming back. So he went to toilet. When he came back, this Muslim boy had just fell flat on his back and he is doing his japa. You can see his hand. On the heart he has kept his hand. He was doing japa and his life is no more. So Gangadhar was so much moved to, when the prayer is going on, looking at Sri Ramakrishna's picture, he is doing japa and giving up his body. What more is required for this fellow to reach the feet of Sri Ramakrishna? He is certainly at the feet of Sri Ramakrishna. And he used to tell this one, Brahmananji has blessed on that day, your boys will cross the ocean of life. Here is the example. He is a Muslim boy, but he has prayed 2 times to Sri Ramakrishna, morning and evening. See the result. Praying just in a 2 minutes time earlier, he was arrived. By the time I came, how smoothly he has given up this world, gone away to Sri Ramakrishna. So many experiences used to be there. So he used to serve these orphan people so much. Everybody was so much moved. Then they made him. Later on, Swami Shivananji passes away in 1934. He was the president of our order. Then Akhandananji is elected as the president. So when he was elected as the president, he said, I will not be residing in Belur Math. I am attached to my orphanage and the orphan children. I will be in Sargachi for some time. I will come to Belur Math now and then. He has to come via Calcutta only every time. Sargachi is about 50 miles from Calcutta. So from there he used to come to Calcutta. From Calcutta he used to go to Belur Math and leave for some time. Again go back. Once, you know, he had come to Calcutta. In Calcutta he had a disciple. She was the Rani of Kuch Bihar state. She was a very rich lady and a very, very great devotee of him. So she requested him, Maharaj, you please come and stay in your bungalow. Give us the opportunity to serve you. You are our guru. All right, he agreed and went. And then they served him so much. So he was not leaving the bungalow at all. So our Swami said, Belur Math. They got the idea that he has left Sargachi on his way to Belur Math, but he is not coming at all. 2 days, 3 days, 4 days are there. So they came to know that he is staying with the Rani of Kuch Bihar, her bungalow in Calcutta. Then our Swamijis went, 2-3 Swamijis, they went and accosted him. Sir, you see, for 2-3 days earlier you have started, we are all expecting you in Belur Math. And you did not come, you are sitting here. Then Akhandananda says, yes, I am sitting here. I am being taken care of so well. You see, my disciple is here. She has put a Kansama in charge of me. And then the Kansama is the person who supplies everything. Food, other conveniences. This Kansama is giving him tea 3 times in a day. And food 4 times in a day. And it attends to all my needs. How much service they are doing. Why should I leave this one and come to you? Then this Swami thought, how to take this Swami from here? We cannot tell him, we will give you more than this at our place. So how to make this Swami tempt this Swami to come to Belur Math? One of them thought of an idea. All right, let us play this trick. Then they went to him. Sir, don't think that you are the happiest man here. We are happier than you in Belur Math. Huh? How are you happier then? Are you served 3 times tea there and 4 times food there? And is there Kansama for each one there? No, we may not be having Kansama. We may not be having 3 times, 4 times tea and 3 times food. But every early morning, we attend the Aarti of Sri Ramakrishna. Then we go to Swamiji's temple. There again there is Aarti, Mangalarti in the morning. We sit before Swamiji and see the Mangalarti. Then sing for Swamiji and meditate. Huh? Before Swamiji you won't sing. I will also come now itself. Swamiji's love was so much tempting. Immediately it will call that Rani. No, no, no. Here I cannot stay. Swamiji's, all these fellows are enjoying Swamiji's prayer and Swamiji's temple. I want to go to Belagavat. He started, gave away. That was his love for Swamiji. So this love of Swamiji was there till the end. All his work he used to do only for the sake of Swamiji. He always used to say, Sri Ramakrishna is difficult to see, but Swamiji you can see in a vision. If you want, he is ready to reveal himself. So first of all, pray to Swamiji, then Sri Ramakrishna also will come. So he was so much attached to Swamiji, that is why the idea of Swamiji of serving God in man became the central point of service in Gangadhar Maharaj's life, Swami Akhandananda's life, serving God in man. So that was the main idea of his life, which he did till the end. Even till the last, he was doing this one in Sargachi. And he had built up an orphanage, he had built up a temple, he had built up a huge agricultural farm where he could teach modern agriculture to the villagers. Then so many welfare activities he was carrying on. Everybody was so much enamored of him for his love and serviceful attitude. In 7th February 1937, so he became very ill. He was carried from Sargachi to Birurmat. There he passed away at his 72nd year. His life was an inspiration to all, especially to those who want to practice Shivajnane Jeeva Seva, serve man as God. So he served like that. We have seen he was bathing the orphan children, pouring water on their head, uttering the Vedic mantras as if they are gods themselves. So this is the great inspiring life of Swami Akhandanandaji. Before he passed away, he said, all of you I will bless. Those people that have helped me, those that have given me trouble, for everybody I will give my blessing. I will not be cheated because there is no good or bad. Everybody is Narayana only. Therefore, I bless everyone. So, I cannot be cheated at this last moment. And then he also said, I know I belong to God. I belong to Sri Ramakrishna. No blemish can touch me. So, all of you are having all sins. Give the sins to me. Take all my merits to you. I am not afraid of sins because they cannot touch me because I have touched the feet of God. That was Gangadhar Maharaj. He felt that he was one with Sri Ramakrishna. No sin can touch. All of you give me your sins. I am not afraid of it. Take all my merits and be happy. And I will never be touched by any of the sin because I am one with Sri Ramakrishna. So that was great Akhandanandaji, and we are lucky today that we could reminisce some of the important incidents in his life. May Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swamiji and Swami Akhandanandaji bless us all. Niranjanam nityamanantarupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai Ishavataram Parameshamidyam Tam Ramakrishnam Shirasanamama.